Welcome to Italics, television for the Italian-American experience. I'm your host, Anthony Tamburri. With us this month is Henry Fiol, a legend in the world of salsa music, where he has worked as a singer, songwriting, musician, and producer. Half Italian and half Puerto Rican, Fiol understood Italian before he learned Spanish as a teenager in high school. His novel recently published, The Short End of the Stick, chronicles the life of an Italian-American boy who was raised in Italian Harlem during the 1950s and 1960s.
Well, I was born and raised in New York City, in Washington Heights, and my father is Puerto Rican, and my mother is born in New York also, but her parents, my grandparents, are from Calabria. Well, my grandparents lived across the street, so I spent most of my childhood in their house. I would go there for lunch every day. In those days, you used to go home for lunch from school and eat supper there like 6 days a week. And I spent my childhood in my grandparents' house most of the time listening to Italian. My grandfather, to describe him, was a very big influence on me because I spent more time with him than with my own father because I was with him every day. His name was Domenico Alcaro, and my grandma, her name was Marietta Posella. My mother's maiden name is Alcaro. And both of my grandparents came from the same town in Calabria, in Provincia di Catanzaro. The name of the town is Borgia. And my grandfather was a very old school gentleman, and he was a custom tailor. And he used to, every day he would stay in his own apartment with a tie and a vest and his watch chain. It would have to be 95 degrees before I ever saw him in his undershirt, never. And he would go for his passeggiata after supper, drink his little glass of wine with his pinky. He was a very refined gentleman. And he taught me a lot of my values as a person I learned from him. And my grandma was a very sweet lady. She was a stereotypical Italian grandma. She had the combs in her hair. And she was very sweet. She had a beautiful voice. And she was a great cook. And I had great times with her. And my both of them were a big influence on me. Sometimes they would talk to me in Calabrese, and I would answer back in English. You know, my problem was is that I never studied Italian in school. They didn't offer Italian in school. I would have loved to have studied Italian. Even though my father was Puerto Rican, we didn't speak Spanish at home. When my relatives would come from Puerto Rico, I would hear some Spanish, but my mother didn't speak Spanish, and we didn't speak Spanish at home. So I learned Spanish in high school. And then after that, when I got interested in Latin music and with my girlfriends and singing in Spanish, my Spanish got better and better. I was doing a performance in Paris with my band, and my mother had passed away at that time. And I had this desire to see my roots. And I took a train from Paris all the way down to the bottom of the boot, to the instep of the boot, where Calabria is. All my life, I've always felt very uncomfortable in flat places. And I didn't know why. And I had to take a bus to Borgia. The bus starts to go winding in the mountains. And then on the top of a mountain, so I understood why I like the mountains so much and why I hate the flat land the way I do. Because I'm from the mountains, that's my blood, you know? And it was a very beautiful experience. It's no fancy town, it's a small town, maybe about 7,000 people. I never look at photographs. I have suitcases full of photos that I never, after my parents died, my grandparents died, I have them in the closet, I never look at photos. The natural thing is to live now in the present. And I try to always live in the present and I don't look back. Because if I look at photos of my grandparents, my parents, my children when they were small, it makes me sad. My grandfather was a big opera fan, and he used to sit in his chair by the window and he used to sing opera arias, you know, hum. But he had a funny way of humming. He wouldn't go like la da da or dum di dum. He would go dwa 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 and dwa 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 dwa. And it's very interesting, the Italian way of holding a cigarette. He used to smoke, and you know, we hold a cigarette like this, or like this, you know. But he would hold his cigarette like this. Only Italians, I think, hold their cigarette like this, you know? And he named his daughters, both of them, after operas. My mother's name is Celeste in English, Celeste, from Celeste Aida, the opera. And my aunt, my mother's sister, my grandfather named her Gioconda, from the opera La Gioconda. But my aunt always hated that name because she was very Americanized, and she never, if you said Gioconda, she'd get very upset. And her name was, to everybody called her Jean. He had a Victrola with the handle and the 78 records. But every once in a while, they would play some Italian music. And I remember to this day, one of my favorite Christmas songs is Tu scendi dalle stelle. To me is the most beautiful Christmas song that there is. I don't know all of the words, but it goes, Tu scendi dalle stelle, o re del cielo, fue nato pagne fuoco mio signore. And then there's the part that goes very quiet and it goes, Oh, bambino mio divino, io ti vedo, vedo tremare. Da, 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 da. I remember from when I was a kid. To me, that I get emotional when I hear that song. It's very, to me, it's very beautiful. That's all. It brings back a lot of memories to me. Now, when I was a boy, I identify as an Italian boy because I was with Italian people. I would see my father, yeah, and my relatives once in a while, but I was basically an Italian boy. But then when I became an adolescent around 13, 14, we went to Puerto Rico and I was old enough to appreciate it. And I'm a visual artist, so it's such a beautiful island that I fell in love with Puerto Rico and my culture that I had squashed for so many years. And then what happened is that I did a flip-flop and I started to identify more as a New Yorican or a Puerto Rican. And I got involved in Latin music. I made a career as a Latin musician, a Latin singer, in Spanish, you know. But the truth is that as I got older, I realized that in my, I don't like to use the expression heart of hearts because we only have one heart, but in the essence of my being, I feel that I'm more Italian than Puerto Rican. And that caused me a lot of conflicts in the Latin music business because there's a lot of cultural things that come up. I was coming out of an Italian bag, doing things Italian style, and they're doing things Latino style, and sometimes, you know, and I would get very angry, very frustrated. I shouldn't say an Italian thing, but it was something in my particular home that was emphasized, is being honest and keeping your word. You know, it's like a point of honor, and to be on time, because if you're not on time, it's a disrespect to the other person. And to this day, I still have those problems because I'm basically an Italian person in a Latino world.
Ay, nena, no te compares, que tiene un cuerpo que ya tú sabes, que tumba esquina, tumba calle, que todo el mundo te dice, mami.
I've been in this Latin music business 51 years, I think, at this point. And I think the time has come for me to, maybe not to retire completely, but just to be very selective about the performances that I accept. That's my attitude looking towards the future right now. It's been more than a year just basically staying home, staying home and just trying to stay safe. I never studied music. I'm like an ear musician. And I studied fine arts in Hunter College. The conceptual art of the mid-60s, the minimalists, these were my teachers. I had a teacher that was on the cover of Time magazine, you know, and their traditional art, realistic painting, and that was very frowned upon. Everything was like on the cutting edge, and I was a realistic painter at that time, and I got involved in doing abstract painting. And even though I studied art, and that was my first love, I got very disillusioned, very disappointed with the reality of the art world and the art scene. And to this day, it turns me off. It turns me off big time. And I came to the crossroads in my life, and little by little, I took the path of music. I would paint my album covers. In those days, it was LPs. Working on a series of abstract paintings, I started thinking that music is just sound waves. And for some reason, our ear has been tuned up and we hear certain notes together and harmonies and melodies, and we get an emotional reaction to this sound. All it is sound waves. But when it comes to color, people's eyes are not tuned up to color the way their ears are tuned up to sound. So what I've been trying to do in my paintings is to isolate color, and to keep the same way you have two notes in the same octave, if they're like a third apart, for example, they ring together, bing, and it's a harmony. Well, you have colors that are harmonious, just like notes of music. It's very interesting that there's, you know, do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do is like seven notes, and that there's seven colors in the rainbow also. I use colors that are in the same octave, just like notes in the same octave, so that when they're next to each other, they ring. And then that's what I've been, that's the concept that I've been working on. And all of these paintings are the same size, and they're all on trapezoids. They're not on rectangles. It's a series of paintings that is focusing on color, using color in a musical way. You know, it's funny, a lot of people, they notice that my style in singing Latin music is very unusual, and they don't know why I sing the way I do. And part of it is because I studied the old Cuban singers, and I learned a lot from that. But it's in my blood, the Italian blood. Italians are always, when they sing, they're always behind the beat. It's the opposite of staccato, it's rubato, you know? So in other words, you wouldn't sing, Que bella cosa, nuyona de sole. That's right on the beat. An Italian wouldn't sing that way. It would be, Que bella cosa, nuyona de sole. I'm exaggerating, but you know, that behind the beat style of singing is something that is in my blood. And I guess when I got into Latin music, it comes up subconsciously or unconsciously, it comes out in my singing. Talking about that song Oriente, the lyrics, the original lyrics have to do with things from Cuba that I didn't really identify with. And the words were like not too important to me. But what grabbed me was the minor key and the melancholy feeling of the song. It's like blues. When you have a guajira in minor key, it's almost like the blues. A lot of singers are afraid to open up, because the more you open up, the more vulnerable you are. You see what I'm saying? So Oriente, is a very sad song to me, and I slowed it down. And I added my own decima. Which had to do with my own personal tragedies in my life. My first son is born blind, and that was a big, maybe that's one of the reasons why I left painting, because my son could never understand what I was doing, because he was blind from birth. I like to sing songs coming from me, coming from my heart, and I use the first person. This is how I feel, and I'm singing from my heart, telling you how I feel. Tanto llanto, tanto llanto, ha caído de estos ojos, persiguiendo una ilusión. So when you do that, you're opening up and you're making yourself more vulnerable. You're taking a big risk to sing from your heart in the first person.
Y no se puede desesperar, ya no se puede guardar rencor. Hay que enterrar toda la pena y olvidar el dolor. Cuando la naturaleza brinda su belleza y te besa.
I'm a composer. I write most of my own songs. So in other words, my message is not a second-hand message. My message is first-hand, because it's coming from me. I'm the creator of the message, and I'm the messenger at the same time. So that's part of what makes my style of singing or my style of music a little bit different.
Es que me gusta oír la rumba sonar por mi barrio.
When I write my songs and I make my records, I'm not interested in improvising. Being in the moment and doing things improvised spontaneously, that's a very beautiful thing too. I don't want to say that that's something that's, you know, doesn't have value, because it does. It's a very beautiful thing. Puerto Ricans or Latinos in general would accept me quicker than an Italian would accept me as another Italian. You follow what I'm saying? Oh, you're half Puerto Rican. You know, you're not a real, you're not 100%, you know. You see what I'm saying? After my mother died, and after I went to Calabria, I realized that I had went too heavy into the Puerto Rican side of my being or myself, and I felt that I had to get back and reconnect and recapture my Italianità, if you want to call it that, my Italianness, right? Well, first of all, I should say that my father was always involved in the racetrack and racehorses. He eventually became a trainer, a racehorse trainer, and I grew up going to the racetrack, and that's my favorite sport. I follow the horses, that, you know, from my father, right?
My new book, entitled The Short End of the Stick, it's a novel about an Italian-American boy named Joey Pocella,
who lives on 115th Street, between First Avenue and Pleasant Avenue in what used to be called Italian Harlem. Now, I remember because we used to go there. We used to take the bus for the Feast of Mount Carmel, and when I was a kid, every year, and I remember the neighborhood. And anyway, this is a story of a boy who is born with a handicap called LLD, leg length discrepancy. He has one leg shorter than the other. And then he's short and he's skinny, and he's limps, and they call him Shrimpy Gimp, and they make fun of him. And he wants to belong, and he wants to fit in, and he's rejected, right?
You know, not for nothing, but I could never understand why some people are born with both cheeks of their dipped in gold, while other people have to carry a heavy cross with them through their whole lives, like being born blind, or deaf, or mute, or deformed, or paralyzed, or retarded, or with a hair lip, or an ugly birthmark, or without any parents, or dirt poor, or crippled, like me. That's why through the years, I've never been able to believe in God or get into religion that much. I grew up hearing stuff like, God is love and God loves you. But even when I was a kid, I'd always think to myself, hey, if God is love and God loves me so much, then how come God ain't fair? How come some people get the ice cream sundae with the whipped cream and the cherry and other people get the short end of the stick? Well, it's taken me a long time to cut through all the bull. But if there's one thing I've learned for sure, is that life ain't fair. Fair got nothing to do with nothing. Never has, never will. You just gotta play the cards the way they're dealt.
And then what happens is, he goes to the racetrack with his uncle and he falls in love with the racetrack and he gets the idea in his head, I wanna be a jockey because if when I'm on the top of the back of the horse, my legs don't mean nothing. And I'm just as good as everybody else.
Joey, the main character, has realized his dream. He's become a jockey. And now it's his big moment. He's riding his horse, Red, in the Belmont Stakes. Red leaps out from under me like a lion, pouncing on his prey, grabbing the ground with his hooves, ripping through the rain and biting the wind. All I can do is hang on and bury myself in his mane. I got no plan. I got no scheme. I'm lost, tossed on a sea of circumstances like a leaf on a runaway wave. The pilot has become the passenger. And as we swing into the first turn, I can feel Red dragging me to the lead, splishing and splashing, skipping and skimming over the slop as if he had wings on his feet. The reins hang loose in my hands, and as I rock to the rhythm of his stride, I can feel myself spacing out like a junkie, nodding out in the saddle, high off the hoofbeats, high off the heartbeats, drunk from drinking too much wind and too much rain. Who knows how fast we're going? Who knows if there's enough gas in the tank? Who cares? Red sure don't, and I don't either. We're inside time, inside the zone, running free, soaring, sailing, spinning, speeding, shaking loose, slipping and sliding in the joy of the moment like two cons busting out of jail.
It was very good for me because I was able to get all of that Italian thing that I have been suppressing for so many years with my Latino lifestyle, and I was able to bring it all out. And now, after writing that story, I don't have an identity problem anymore because now I know who I am. I'm a Henry Fiol. And I'm a nectarine, that's who I am. I'm not a peach, and I'm not a plum. I'm a nectarine, you know? So now I'm balanced out, I'm even. And I feel very good about myself. I'm happy to be a nectarine, and that's it. I've never had the opportunity before today to really talk about it, you know?
Thank you for watching this episode of Italics. I'm Anthony Tamburri. Arrivederci alla prossima puntata.